In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Church established the Feast of All Saints in order to render to all of them due honor and veneration. But it is her intention also to remind us of our own call to become saints and show us the way to do so by placing the saints before our eyes as models for our imitation. To become a saint does not imply at all anything extraordinary, such as the performance of miracles or astonishing bodily mortifications. Neither does it require that one be canonized, since many saints are known only to God and heaven. Sanctity consists in earnestly tending with all our strength to Christian perfection, which perfection consists essentially in a great degree of charity, that is, of the love of God for his own self and of neighbor for God. It is this virtue of charity which corresponds to the two greatest precepts given us by Christ, which are the end of all the other precepts and counsels. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with thy whole heart and with thy whole soul and with all thy strength and with all thy mind and thy neighbor as thyself. In the encyclical Rerum Omnium of 1923, Pius XI reasserts the universal call to sanctity and the crucial role of the saints in our striving after it. The Church, he writes, is most successful in this work of sanctification when it is possible for her to hold up to the imitation of the faithful one or other of her dearest children who has made himself conspicuous by the practice of every virtue. This work of sanctification the Church performs in accordance with her own very nature, since she was made by Christ, her founder, not only holy herself, but the source of holiness. All who accept her as their guide and teacher ought, by the command of God, to do everything in their power to sanctify their own lives. As St. Paul says, "This is the will of God, your sanctification." And Christ himself has taught what this sanctification consists in. "Be ye therefore perfect, as your heavenly Father is perfect." And then the Pope rejects as false the idea that only some are called to become saints. "We cannot accept," he says, "the belief that this command of Christ concerns only a select and privileged group of souls, and that it is permitted to the rest to remain in a certain lower degree of virtue. Quite the contrary is true, as appears from the very universality of Christ's words. This law of holiness embraces all men and admits of no exception. The great number of souls of every condition in life, both young and old, who, as history informs us, have reached the summit of Christian perfection, these saints felt in themselves the weaknesses of human nature and had to conquer the selfsame temptations as we." Saint Alfonso said, "They then who say God does not wish us all to be saints make a great mistake. Yes, for Saint Paul says, this is the will of God, your sanctification. God wills that all be saints, and each one according to his state of life, the religious as a religious, the layman as a layman, the priest as a priest, the married as married, the man of business as a man of business, the soldier as a soldier, and so of every other state in life. Every Christian then must strive for sanctity or the perfection of charity according to the general obligation of the first and greatest commandment. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with thy whole heart. How shall he do this? By avoiding mortal sin and venial sin, by having the spirit of the evangelical counsels of obedience, chastity, and poverty, without binding himself to practice those which do not correspond to his state in life, and by thus growing in charity until death. If a Christian follows this way generously, he will certainly reach to a very high perfection. And this is true sanctity, to which he can certainly attain in the lay state, as is proven from the countless canonized saints who belonged to that state, and which the Church proposes for our imitation no less than the religious or priests. The Church presents the saints as our models, that by imitating their virtues, we ourselves may attain to sanctity to which we are also called. Saint Paul, having reached sanctity, set himself, under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, as a model to be imitated by the other Christians, even the lay persons. Be ye followers of me, he says, and observe them who walk so as you have our model. And this is what the saints say to us from heaven. Be you followers of us, and by the help of God's all-powerful grace, you will also become saints. You see us now radiant in glory, but we were one day where you are now, and were surrounded by the same miseries and trials. We were, just as you are, weighed down by the same body of sin, as St. Paul calls it. We were tempted, even violently, by the same temptations of the flesh, of the devil, and of the world. But see how Christ's grace is stronger than man's inclination to evil, stronger than all the devils, stronger than the world. It was not our natural strength that brought us here, but the grace of Christ, which is also now offered to you. Have courage. If you strive to follow our example, we will aid you by our powerful intercession. If you only sincerely aim at imitating us, we will be your friends and special helpers when you invoke us with confidence. Do not be discouraged at the difficulties, the temptations, or the sight of your misery. Put all your hope in the help of God and of his saints. If you do not resist the grace that is offered to you, but strive to cooperate with it, it will bring you also, as it has brought us, to this eternal and perfect happiness we now enjoy. God calls you today, by the example and prayers of his saints, to convert, full of confidence in the power of the grace of Christ, the grace that changed Saul from his persecutor to his great apostle, a great sinner into a Saint Mary Magdalene, and a proud and unchaste youth into a Saint Augustine. And the same can be said of Saint Mary of Egypt, Saint Pelagia, and many others. Even if you have been for many years and are still now in the chains of sin, you should hope, if you sincerely repent and confess your sins, not only to attain eternal salvation, but also to become a saint. Consider the life of Saint Margaret of Cortona. She was born in Labiano, Tuscany, in the year 1247. She strayed from the path of virtue in her youth, and to the great scandal of the people, she lived for 9 years with a man outside of marriage. Upon the sudden and horrible death of her sinful companion, which she regarded as a judgment from heaven, she resolved upon doing penance for her past sins. With this purpose, she went to Cortona, made a heartfelt confession, and placed herself under the direction of the Franciscan Fathers. From that time, she gave herself up to prayer, penance, and works of mercy, nursing the sick and the poor. Saint Alphonsus writes, "In the life of Saint Margaret of Cortona, we read that when our Lord visited her one day with great tokens of tenderness and love, she exclaimed, 'But, O Lord, have you then forgotten what I have been? Is it possible that you can repay all my outrages against you with so exquisite sweetness?' And God replied that when a soul loves him and heartily repents of having offended him, he forgets all her past infidelities. As indeed he formerly spoke by the mouth of Ezekiel, 'If the wicked do penance, I will not remember all his iniquities.' And in proof of this, as adds the holy doctor, he showed her a high throne which he had prepared for her in heaven in the midst of the seraphim. She indeed, who had been a great sinner for many years, was lifted by the power of the grace of Christ to such a degree of sanctity that God worked through her many miracles, even the raising of a dead person to life. She died in the odor of sanctity in the year 1297, 24 years after her conversion." Following the approbation of several of her miracles, the popes approved her veneration, and she was formally and solemnly canonized by Benedict XIII in Pentecost Sunday, 1728, her feast day being February 22nd. By placing such penitent saints upon the very altars of God, the Church shows us that the grace of Christ is far more powerful than sin, and that it is never too late to become a saint if we truly repent and put all our confidence in his infinite mercy. May Saint Margaret and all the saints intercede for us, that we may imitate their virtues and by the grace of Christ become worthy of enjoying their blessed company in heaven. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.